Antietam National Military Park is one of the most visited battlefields in the United States. And this church, commonly known as Dunker Church, is its most famous and visited landmark. Stonewall Jackson had his headquarters here, and some of the fiercest fighting of the battle unfolded within sight of it.
Today we're taking a walking battlefield tour of Antietam, and rather than visiting the usual sites that gets the most attention, I think we should try something a little different.
You mean you don't want to go walk across Burnside's Bridge for the 100th time?
No, I think we should go to the more unusual sites that don't get as many visitors.
Okay, I like that. How about we each pick three of our favorite monuments that are on the battlefield that tell the story of the battle?
That sounds good. I'm Keith, that's Greg, this is Little Wars TV.
Thanks to McClellan's incompetence and hands-off command style, the battle unfolded in three loosely coordinated phases. The opening phase kicked off at dawn with Hooker's 1st Corps attacking toward Dunker Church, through the West Woods, and a 30-acre field that would come to be known simply as the Cornfield. There are nearly 100 monuments on this battlefield, but only 5 of them are Confederate. And this is one of those 5. By 7 a.m., Stonewall Jackson's line is under heavy pressure from Federal attack, and he calls up the 2,300 men of Hood's division. This includes one of the toughest units in the Army, the veteran Texas Brigade. The Texas Brigade is interrupted from eating their first hot meal in days and ordered to march from behind Dunker Church and counterattack through the Miller Cornfield. They drive back the Federal advance and stabilize Jackson's defensive front, but at horrific cost. The 1st Texas loses 82% of its men within less than 20 minutes, the highest casualty rate suffered by any Confederate regiment in the entire war. At company roll call the following morning, not a single man from F Company was left, only one from Company A, 2 men of Company C. The devastation in the cornfield was so terrible that General Hooker later wrote, "Stalks of corn looked like they'd been cleanly cut by a knife."
Hood's Texans weren't fighting alone. They were part of a larger counterattack that included men from 3 other Confederate divisions, all intent on breaking the Federal flank and retaking the cornfield. That's where the rebels ran into Battery B of the 4th U.S. Artillery. 3 men won the Medal of Honor, manning these guns of Battery B, the most heavily engaged Federal unit in the battle, and they were positioned here to stem the Confederate counterattack that morning. When the battery commander was wounded, 15-year-old bugler Johnny Cook led his wounded captain to the rear and had the courage to return to the maelstrom. He grabbed a pouch from a wounded gunner and began loading the guns himself. He fired a canister blast right at the rebels, just 20 feet from here, stopping their advance cold. In 1894, he was finally awarded the Medal of Honor, making him one of the youngest recipients in history. Battery B lost 44 men and 40 horses during the morning of the battle, more than double the losses of any Federal artillery unit here. Johnny Cook survived the war and was buried with full military honors at Arlington Cemetery in 1915.
With his attack faltering and now under pressure from rebel counterattack, General Hooker called upon the 12th Corps under Joseph K. Mansfield to join the fray. This is the Mansfield Monument, erected by his home state of Connecticut in 1900. Joseph K. Mansfield has a very interesting personal story at this battle, and it's one of my favorites. Mansfield was over 59 years old at the time of the battle, one of the oldest generals on the field. He was a West Pointer who graduated 2nd in his class, just like Lee and McClellan. He pulled all the strings he could to leave his Washington desk job and be granted a field command, which came to him just days before this battle. Answering Hooker's call for aid, Mansfield led his men on horseback from the front, trying to set an example of courage, since half the men in the Corps were raw recruits. We're now about 40 yards away from that monument at a downward-facing cannon. This marks the location of Mansfield's mortal wound. He's directing his Corps when fire from the nearby woods first hits his horse and then hits him clean through the chest. Mansfield died at a field hospital the next morning.
Not long after Mansfield was wounded, General Hooker is shot through the foot, and the entire Federal attack on the northern end of the battlefield sputters out. It's around this time, in the late morning, when the second phase of the battle begins to unfold. A Union division from Edwin Sumner's 2nd Corps drifts south and runs into rebel troops defending this sunken road. Alerted to the new action, Sumner starts feeding more of his men into the center of the battlefield. Now, despite my Pennsylvania Dutch background, I love the Irish Brigade. Even at the time of this battle, this is one of the most famous units in the Federal Army, and this monument is dedicated to their attack on this sunken road. This was actually the 4th attack Sumner threw at the road, and was rapidly piling up with massive casualties. The back of the monument features the image of the colorful brigade commander Thomas Marr. He was exiled from Ireland to Tasmania for supporting Irish independence, and after a few years escaped to the US. His brigade was made mostly of Irish immigrants from New York. They mounted a furious bayonet charge against the North Carolina Brigade defending the road and suffered almost 40% casualties. Now, during the battle in this field behind us, Marr falls from his horse under debatable circumstances.
I believe for the record that he claimed the horse was shot out from under him.
Maybe, but some of the men in the brigade said he was drunk on whiskey. So, in that Irish tradition...
You do know that you're not allowed to have alcohol at a national park.
Oh, of course not. This is apple juice. To the Irish.
To Marr.
To Marr.
What kind of apple juice was this again?
Jameson.
The Irish brigade was driven back, but repeated federal attacks weakened the precariously thin rebel line. By early afternoon, the Bluecoats finally achieved a breakthrough, and in a flash, Lee's center was on the verge of utter collapse. With Confederates in flight from the sunken road, 2nd Lieutenant William Chamberlain of the 6th Virginia went to collect reinforcements from General Anderson's brigade, but was informed the general was already wounded. Sorting through the chaos of the moment, Chamberlain collected other rebel officers and fleeing infantry to take up positions right here behind this stone wall. This monument, known as the 6th Virginia Monument, marks the location where Chamberlain spotted an abandoned cannon and found four men to help him drag it into the Hagerstown Pike, where they fired alone for nearly an hour. He was struck in the face by shrapnel, but survived not just this battle, but the rest of the war. William Chamberlain was honored for his heroism after the war by surviving Confederate veterans, who collected money for this monument in his honor. It was the first Confederate monument placed on the battlefield and the only one paid not with state funds, but directly by veterans, which I think makes it a pretty special stop for anybody visiting here.
Now, this was a decisive moment in the battle when McClellan could have broken Lee's army in half. But the breakthrough was not pursued. Instead, the opportunity was allowed to pass, and Lee cobbled together enough troops to stabilize his line. The final phase of the drama was destined to play out at the other end of the battlefield.
I know we promised not to come here, but honestly, it's hard to visit Antietam without stopping at Burnside's Bridge. While the battle raged all morning, the Union 9th Corps was deployed on this side of Antietam Creek, engaging in a skirmish with a few hundred Georgians that were defending the opposite side of the bridge.
Eventually, Burnside did manage to storm the bridge and deploy his 12,000 men in a mile-long line, intending to smash Lee's exposed flank. Had Burnside been just 1 hour earlier, he might have cut off Lee's army from the Potomac and destroyed them.
But at this critical moment, when all seemed lost for the Confederate cause, Lee's salvation arrived via forced march from Harper's Ferry. A.P. Hill's division ended a grueling 17-mile forced march by emerging through a tall cornfield and crashing into the end of Burnside's line.
It was a devastating blow. And for our last monument on this battlefield tour, I want to talk about one of the men involved in that decisive moment. This cannon is dedicated to one of the brigadier commanders in the attack, General Lawrence O'Brien Branch. He was one of three Confederate generals killed at Antietam, and by any measure, he was a fairly remarkable man. Branch was 41 at the time of the battle. He led a busy life, a Princeton graduate, first in his class, former U.S. congressman, entrepreneur, lawyer, and army veteran before the war. He enlisted as a private in 1861, rose through the ranks, and was a veteran of a dozen major engagements by this time in the war. We're at a downward-facing cannon, so you can probably guess how Branch's story ends. His men were pursuing the retreating Yankees toward the bridge when he rode up to meet with A.P. Hill and three other brigadiers. The group drew attention from sharpshooters, and Branch was shot in the face, killed instantly at this location. He was truly one of the rising stars in Lee's army, and a costly casualty. After the war, A.P. Hill would later write of Branch, "He was my senior brigadier and one to whom I could have entrusted command of the division with all confidence. No country has a better son or nobler champion, no principal a bolder defender than the noble and gallant soldier, General Lawrence O'Brien Branch."
That story's kind of a downer to end our battlefield walk.
Well, did you think the bloodiest day in American history was going to have a happy ending?
Fair point. If you find yourself at Antietam one day, I recommend you stop here, at the observation tower near the sunken road, to get a commanding view of the battlefield and imagine the carnage and confusion of that day. The great battle ended here by 5:30 p.m., and in an amazing act of brazen boldness or suicidal recklessness, Lee refused to retreat that night. He remained through the following day, daring McClellan to try again. For better or worse, our young Napoleon didn't have the same stomach for blood as the actual Napoleon.
McClellan was relieved of command less than 2 months after the battle for failing to pursue Lee and missing a golden opportunity to end the war much earlier than it did.
Thanks for joining us for this extended battlefield walk. It was fun. We should do it again sometime.
Absolutely. And if you enjoyed the walk, you should like the video and subscribe to Little Wars TV. You should also be sure to watch our massive Antietam War Game. See how we rewrite history.
And if you'd like to walk along with a couple of history nerds at a different battlefield, leave us a comment on this video and let us know where you'd like to go next. We'll see you next week.